Y'all might welcome my good friend Ray Ayler. He served the United States of Marine Corps. He's a Marine through and through. Y'all give Ray a big hand as he gives us a soldier's prayer.
Family when I was in Iraq, brothers and sisters that are not here and able to stand up and be a part of this, be a part of everyday life. You know, I deal with issues every day of those thoughts, but I am truly blessed to be up here today and be accepted into this family. It's changed my life the last 3 years. And I haven't been here about the past 2 months dealing with those issues and the seeds of doubt that the devil plants. But I'm just so humbled. And it's given me a peace in my heart to be a part of this church family. And I wish my wife was here, but she's working today. She's mad because she's not here. She loves this place as well as I do. But I'm going to read a little bit, so just bear with me. It's rough. You know, it's to stand up in front of men going into battle and give op orders and intel dumps and stuff like this, that's easy for me. But to stand up here in front of y'all, it's scary. And it's not that you're going to judge me or whatever, or it's different. You know, I didn't start off real well in this church, you know, because I had issues. You know, I love my family, and I can remember going up, and I'm sorry for this, man, but I got to get it off my heart. You know, I was telling guys, you know, I'd kick their butt if they messed with my family, and that was that mentality. I was still over there. That's the mentality the Marine Corps puts in you. You know, it's a facade. But it's been broken down since I've been here. And it's not hard to walk up here. It's hard to bend that knee and release. And I didn't plan on this, man. This is just coming out. God has got his hand on us. It's if we're perceptive enough to take his guidance and the Lord's guidance. So let me get out of here so my man back here can get on with his business. Lord, first we ask you to hold our troops in your loving hands. Protect them as they protect us. Bless them and their families, which is the hardest job in the military, for the selfless acts that they perform for us in our time of need. Lord, we ask for courage to face and conquer our own fears, courage to take us where no others will go, and that's that valley. We ask for strength of our body to protect others, strength of spirits to lead others. We ask for dedication to our job to do it well, dedication to our country to keep it safe. Give us, O Lord, concern for those who trust us and compassion for those who need us. And please, Lord, through it all, be at our side. We'd ask this in Jesus' name, and everybody say amen.
Just trying to be a father, raise a daughter and a son, be a lover to their mother, everything to everyone. Up and at them bright and early, I'm all business in my suit. Yeah, I'm dressed up for success, from my head down to my boots. I don't do it for the money, there's bills that I can't pay. I don't do it for the glory, I just do it anyway. Providing for our futures, my responsibility. Yeah, I'm real good under pressure, being all that I can be. I can't call in sick on Mondays when the weekend's been too strong. I just work straight through the holidays, sometimes all night long. You can bet that I stand ready when the wolf growls at the door. Hey, I'm solid, hey, I'm steady, hey, I'm true down to the core. And I will always do my duty, no matter what the price. I've counted up the cost, I know the sacrifice. Oh, and I don't want to die for you, but if dying's asking me, I'll bear that cross with honor, cause freedom don't come free. I'm an American soldier, an American. Beside my brothers and my sisters, I will proudly take a stand. I'm out here on the front lines, sleep in peace tonight. American soldier, I'm an American soldier. Yeah.
Come on, y'all give all those guys and gals a big hand. Come on, church. Wow. Praise the Lord. I don't know if you picked it out or not, but man, what an amazing array of men and women who've served and are still serving today, all the way from World War II and forward, even presently, that are standing watch. And I've been speaking on this idea of healthy friendships. Remember, we started a few weeks ago with this premise that in order to have a friend, you must what? First, be a friend. How many of you have been trying to be a better friend the last few weeks than in the past? Okay, three of you, praise God. And it's just what I believe can be epitomized in a few words. We talked a few weeks ago about the healthy friendships. We talked about the frenemies, you know, those people that are somewhat ambivalent. You're not sure if they're your friend. They really exhaust us. And then we kind of landed on this idea of the true friends last week, talking about frintimacy and that intimacy with friendships and what that really looks like. And I was so interested to see how many of you reached out to me after last Sunday with this idea of frintimacy and what it means in the area of your anxiety and loneliness. We're surrounded by people, yet never before this time in our lives more alone than ever. And yet it's because of that idea of connectivity and friendships. This week, I want to talk to you about healthy friendships in the area of a friend that we have in a soldier. Because here's what I believe to be true. As we survey the veterans across the world today, we realize that is the true willingness of friendships. If you have your Bible, you can turn with me to two verses as I'm kind of leading to this point. The first is John 15. We're going to turn there and hold our spot there. And then 2 Timothy chapter 2, 2 Timothy chapter 2, John 15 and 2 Timothy chapter 2. And in the context of Veterans Day and celebrating these men and women who truly epitomize the greatest level of friendship, the willingness for each American soldier, Marine, sailor, or airman to lay down his life for his country. I, for one, do not take that lightly. How about you? I believe it's something that is inside of each one of us that if you've ever served the military, you know what I'm about to say. It has to be pulled out of us. It is not normative to, when the bullets start flying, to run towards them. It's not normative, even for police officers and first responders, as you see and saw even this week out in California, for when the bullets start flying, to run towards it rather than to run away from it. It's something that has to be pulled out of us. And it's interesting because I believe with all of my heart that it's something that we should all do. Maybe not in a physical bullet, maybe not in a physical war, but in the context of spiritual warfare. We should be running towards the enemy. Greater is he that is in me and you than he that is in this world. Through the Holy Spirit of God, the redemptive blood of Christ, we have the power, the authority to overcome the enemy. And I'm going to tell you something. People in this world today need rescuing. How many of you know that? They need rescuing. We rescue them on the greatest battlefield known to man, and that's the battlefield of life, the war that's raging against good and evil. And here's the good news. The war has already been won. We merely just have to walk in that hope. So the Bible passages that I gave you today, the first one kind of really grabs onto the heartbeat of our series, Healthy Friendships, and it's this. John chapter 15, verses 12 through 14 says this. This is my commandment, that we love one another. It's interesting that Jesus, when asked the question, who can be your disciple? How can we know that we're true followers of you, true disciples of you, learned apostles, following, sold out? And he said this, people can know that you're my followers based on the way you love one another. Notice not all the other religious jargon and narratives that could have come out of that. Hey, I believe church attendance is incredibly important. I believe that fellowship is incredibly important. I believe that giving is incredibly important. I believe that worship is incredibly important. But here's what I believe to be true. The greatest litmus test of a child of God is our ability to love people, even those who are unlovable. And he goes on to say that you love one another even as I have loved you. And then here's our verse. Greater love has no man than one who is willing to lay down his life for his friend. Guys, that's the American soldier. That's the heartbeat of every man, woman, boy, or girl that's ever served or ever will serve. It's the willingness to believe in something bigger than ourselves. In fact, the oath, and you heard me say this many, many times, each of us who served raised our hand, and we took an oath. We solemnly swore to support and defend the Constitution of the United States of America. And watch this. And to defend it against all enemies, both foreign and domestic. And I love the last closing line, so help me God. Not just because we need God's help and assistance, but because it's a mandate of the Scripture. To love. Greater love is no man than to lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do whatever I command you to do, Jesus said. That's our greatest heartbeat of ministry is just to love people. And can I tell you something? That's not always easy. Can I get an amen? Now, some of y'all really woke up at that one. It's not always easy to love the unlovable, but that's the greatest love. Because here's the reality. There is a greater love that's known to us, and that is one, Jesus, who laid down his life not merely for his friends, but he laid down his life for his enemies, you and I. We were an enemy of God, disenfranchised from the fall of man in the garden. Not anything that intrinsically you did. It's born in us, this propensity to sin and to be an enemy of God. And he laid down his life even for his enemies. And then our text for the day is found in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 3 through 4. And this is the Apostle Paul writing to his protege, this young boy in the faith named Timothy, who was encouraged and trained as a soldier. Paul many, many times spoke of himself as a soldier for Christ. He called himself a bondservant. It's interesting, the words that he used in the context of following Jesus. And he said this to his young protege. And it's interesting that as he's writing this, guess where he is? He is in a Roman prison awaiting his imminent death. He ultimately will later be beheaded after he wrote this under Nero's hand in Rome. And yet he's still encouraging. He's still on the battlefield, even though, watch this, even though he's in prison. I submit to you after reading 2 Timothy, I believe that he's more free than many of us who are on the outside of today's prisons, because he knew his mission to still encourage. And listen to what he says. Insert a text from the day. Share in the suffering of a good soldier of Christ Jesus. No soldier gets entangled in civilian pursuits, since his aim, since the soldier's aim, since his sole mission, if I may, is to please the one who enlisted him. Let us pray. Father, we love you today. We thank you for your word that you hold above your name. Help me, God, today to rightly divide it with power, with life-changing words of wisdom and anointing from you. In Jesus' name, and everyone said amen. Today's message is soldier's friendship. If you're sitting there today, you say, that didn't apply to me. I'm not a soldier. I'm not talking about the military soldier. I'm talking about the soldier in the Lord's army. You and I, how many of you are saved? You're born again, washed in the blood of Jesus. You are a soldier. You enlisted in the army of God to do battle against the things of this world. And I'm going to give you four, if I may, qualities today of a good soldier. I'm going to go ahead and tell you that some of this God has prompted me to lay out before you, and I just pray that you receive it in the heartbeat that it was intended for God to convict. He's already moved on my heart in several areas of things that I believe we need to talk about today. Number one, and I believe this to be true, is a good soldier, he knows which side he or she is on. We know who we're fighting for. Can I go ahead and tell you this? We're on the winning team. The battle's been won. There was an old Sandy Patty song. I don't know if you remember it, but it talked about the battle that was still raging inside of you and I. Yet the war has been won. The war has been fought. The war has been won. The blood of Jesus has been spilled, awakening even the dirt that lie beneath the cross that day. And for every single man, woman, boy, or girl who accepts that in faith by his grace, that blood is applied to my life. And I become the righteousness of God through Jesus Christ. The battle's over, yet the war is raging inside of each of us. And maybe sometimes we need to be reminded as a soldier of God which side that we're on. Verse 3 of our text says, share in the suffering as a good soldier. Watch this. Here it is. Of Jesus Christ. Mark, why do you say that? Here's why I say that. Because we are not on the side of a denomination. Now, I'm not splitting hairs. I get it. There's Baptist, there's Methodist, there's Pentecostal, there's Catholicism. And we can go through the gamut, right? And we can all die on that hill of what I believe is unequivocally the absolute truth. But as we die on that hill, we alienate people all the while, ever forgetting the opportunity to be able to minister to them. I'm not on the side of Northridge Church. Hear me. Hear me, church. Hear me if you're watching today. We're not at battle against church to church, one side and another. We're on the team of Christ Jesus. We're not on the team of my church, your church, we and ours and yours and mine. That is divisive. That is a arsenal, a weapon of the enemy to divide and conquer. And doggone it, church, when we decide we're on the team of Jesus, of King Jesus, it's not about dogma. Listen, we sit here all day and debate this, that, or the other. Do we do this? Do we do that? Do we? All the while, we're missing Jesus completely. While we're arguing the gifts of the Spirit between Baptist and Pentecostal, people are dying in the seats in which we preach. I don't know if you pay attention to the news and follow Christian artists, but Lauren Daigle this past couple of 3 weeks has been the commentary of many a Christian. Many pastors have stepped up and unfortunately spoken against her for being on Ellen DeGeneres' show. I only say this to just put in perspective. Stephanie and I have personally met Lauren before, and she is one of the sweetest, kindest, gentlest, most sold-out spirits I've ever met in my life. And you know, it's interesting that we are called to be a light in a dark place. Yet we're always questioned when we go into places of which we don't agree. Rather than my words that may fall short, I want to read to you what Lauren said this week after she also went on another late night show. I think it was Jimmy Fallon. She said this: "It's not up to me and up to you who we are supposed to love. I think the second that we start drawing lines around which people are able to be approached and which are not, we've already completely missed the heart of God." She went on to say, "I do not have all the answers in life, but one thing I know is that I can't pick and choose who I'm supposed to be kind to and who I am not, because that is our mission." She continued, "But who Christ was to everyone, that is what we should be up and about." Listen, make no mistake about it. I believe there should be places that we should stand in truth. But let me tell you, while we go and debate those issues and criticize, you will never, ever, ever hear me criticizing another pastor, whether I agree with him or not, from this place right here. This is sacred. This is not about agendas. This is not about my dogma. This is about the hope of Christ in a lost world. And hear me, when you go on Facebook, and I get it. How many of y'all remember MySpace? Going back a little bit, right? How many of y'all remember Atari? How many of y'all remember before it was that? It was just two paddles that went up and down on either side of the screen to catch a dot. How many of you remember? It was a good day, wasn't it? Black and white TV. Man, it was awesome. It had three channels. We're so stinking spoiled and entitled that we go on Facebook thinking it's my space, and I'm using that loosely, thinking it's my time, my platform. Let me tell you, my friend, let me tell you today, and I'm glad you're watching on Facebook. I just want you to know we love y'all. Not knocking Facebook. I'm just saying, can I tell you something? Christians, men and women of God that are out there, let the pieces fall where they fall. I love you, but I want to tell you in the true heart of what I believe God is saying here today. Here's what I believe. Whatever we say, whatever we write for all to see, we will be judged, whether good or evil, what we just did. And here's what I believe. Those doors out there, and I want you to hear this again in the heartbeat. This is what I'm writing. I'm telling you what God told me to say, so I'm saying it. If you are a part of this church and you have a problem with somebody coming through those doors out there that looks different, that smells different, that acts different, that believes different than you do, you're in the wrong church, because we are about people. We're about all people. To whosoever will, let him come. I don't say that to be arrogant. I say that, Steve, because I believe that's what the cross is about. And doggone it, let's not forget where we come from. We were lost. We were undone. He came after wretched me. Anybody else just feel like you were wretched and undone when he came after you? That's what we're to do, man. We're to love people. So churches, pastors, let me tell you something. Quit condemning Lauren Daigle. Get on your knees and pray for her. She is number 3 on the top 200 Billboard on secular music because God is using her. And I believe we should pray for her. Y'all give the Lord a hand. Come on. Let me tell you why I say that. Let me tell you why I say that. This is not something I have made up. Joshua chapter 5, watch this. "And it came to pass when Joshua went by Jericho that he lifted up his eyes and he looked, and behold, a man stood opposite him with a sword drawn in his hand. And Joshua went to him and said to him, 'Are you for us or are you for our adversaries?'" He said, "Are you on my team or are you on their team?" Watch the answer. He said, "No." I don't know if your kids ever do that. You ask them two questions and they just give you a no. It's an either or, A or B. But watch what happened. "Are you for us or are you for adversaries?" And the answer came back, "No. But as the commander of the Lord's army," he said, "but as the commander of the army of the Lord, I have now come," watch this, in the response, "and Joshua fell upon his face to the earth and worshiped and said to him," here he turns it around, "what does the Lord say to his servant?" I read this, I was sharing this with Brent the other night, I read this many, many years ago, and God just popped me right over the head with this. He says to him, by the way, this is Jesus, a pre-incarnate Jesus. We know that because he was allowed to worship him. Anytime there was an angel, the angel would rebuke them and say, no, get up. I'm merely a messenger. I'm like you. But he allowed him to worship him. And then later on in the verses, he said, "Take off your shoes, for the ground in which you stand is holy ground." So we know this is Jesus. But watch what happens. He basically goes up to the creator, the redeemer of the world, and he says, sword drawn, are you on our team? Are you for me? Are you for them? And it's as if to Jesus said, no, no, you misunderstood the point of my coming. I didn't come here to take sides. I came here to take over. You get in line with me. I'm not about siding with you and your dogma. I know what side I'm on. I've come to fulfill the will of the Father. How about you? The U.S. Army's mantra, established back in 1783, is this. This we'll defend. This, the pronoun we, which the past chief of staff of the Army says, that pronoun we exemplifies the idea of teamwork. Let me tell you something. Every Marine knows it. Every Airman knows it. Every Sailor knows it. Every Soldier knows it. We cannot do the mission without we. Can I tell you something? It's no different in the church. It's easy. It's easy to identify what my calling is, but do you know your calling? Do you know your part in the story that God is writing through his people today, of which you are as big of a part of it as I am? I said this to students many, many years ago. I took a puzzle, and I took this puzzle, and just it was like 500 pieces, and this was many, many years ago. It was a little silly now that I think about it. But I took this puzzle, and I just took it, and I just threw all the pieces out in the crowd, and I said, all right, y'all come reassemble this puzzle. That's the way we look at the church. That's the way we, the church, look sometimes to the lost world. We're like, find your place. And nobody's like, I don't know my place. I don't know my part. We are to help each other find our spot. But watch this. Take a picture. Take a picture of five or six pieces. What's the first piece you're going to put together on the puzzle when you're putting the puzzle together? Somebody shout it out. The edges, the corner piece. Those are easily identifiable, right? That just for the sake of conversation, that might be me. I'd be an edge piece because you can see where I fit in this scheme. You might pick Keith and say, okay, he's a worship leader. But then where do I fit in this thing? But watch this. I'm going to fill in those edge pieces, and then I'm going to work to the center. But watch this. Let's say it's a 5,000-piece puzzle. I put them all together, and one little piece, maybe some little indiscriminate piece right there in the center, a little over to the right, is missing. Guess what the picture is? The picture is incomplete without that one piece. What if you're that one piece today? The story is not being fully told. Maybe it's because we have forgot what side we're on. A child of God's mission today is to defend the we and the ours and not the mine and yours. To defend the word of God, the least of these. If we don't speak up for the least of these out there, the widows and the orphans, who will? James 1:27 said, pure religion, undefiled before God, is when you and I take care of the orphans and the widows. The least of these. So not only do we have to remember whose side we're on, but secondly, we have to maintain a constant state of readiness. Listen to what it says in verse 4 of our text. No soldier gets entangled in civilian pursuits. This speaks of being focused. This speaks of discipline. This speaks of being battle ready. You know, it's interesting that in the Army, you're trained to understand your weapon. I can only speak for the Army because that's what I was in. You're trained to know it inside out. You know your weapon. You can take it apart and you can reassemble it with your eyes closed before it's over and done with. First time you see it, it's alien to you. You take it apart all the way down to the smallest little pin, little retainer pin. But then there's a time where, man, you do it so often, over and over and over and over and over. You sleep with it. You go to the restroom with it. You go everywhere because it is your hope in that moment of battle. Can I tell you something? The Word of God is the sword of the Spirit, your only offensive weapon. It is your job, soldier of the Army of the Lord, to know it inside and out. Well, Mark, when I read it, I don't understand it. Keep reading it. It'll get in you. You will. It may feel alien today, but it will feel close to your heart if you keep in it and keep at it. 2 Corinthians 10:4 says it this way. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty. Everybody say mighty. Mighty to the pulling down of strongholds. Here's what I believe that is often seen in the church today. We have these strongholds. Maybe they're called generational curses. Me and Tim Knight, I tell you, we can't hardly even quote this verse. We just have this thing. We both, you know, he has two sons. I have a son and a daughter, and we talk about this. How many of you have ever heard that the generational curses from your grandfather, your forefathers, it will visit the sons and the daughters to the fourth and the fifth generation? How many of you ever heard that verse? and you walk through life thinking that you're doomed because your dad was an alcoholic and his dad was an alcoholic and his dad was a, so you walk in and go, that's who I am. Read the rest of the verse. But those who love and trust the Lord, they shall be blessed to 1,000 generations. You break it by being battle ready. You got to know the word in order to be able to stand on its promises. There was a story of one of the series of the greatest battles in Afghanistan. The story is told of a full-bird colonel who was the command there at this particular area of control in this region, in which case the local Afghanis were being overthrown. The villages were being taken. People were being murdered and pillaged and so forth by the Taliban. So the military, different branches, but they came into this certain area of this valley to begin to defend against the weaponry of the enemy who had sown in and dug into this mountain. They've been there so long, and they dug in for so long that their defensive position had now become an offensive that could not be overthrown. Because as they would lob mortars and artillery over, 21 miles behind, but they would lob this artillery, 105 and 155 millimeter howitzers. It would hit the mountain, and they would just go deep into the subterranean tunnels and laugh and come back out and yet shoot again, killing many of our soldiers and the friendlies in that region. This went on for weeks, battle after battle after battle, fiercest battles, soldiers being picked off by sniper fire. One of the chiefs of the village or the tribe came up and said, we're not making headway. Of course, the full-bird colonel at the time knew. He said, no, I know we're not, and I get it. So we're calling in for support. A few days went by, and the Afghanis, man, they were anticipating this 5,000-person army just sweeping across that terrain and capping over the hill in this valley and just annihilating the enemy. And 12 men showed up. Can imagine the skepticism that set in with the friendly Afghanis who came to him again. The chief approached him and said, seriously, I'm paraphrasing, what are these 12 men going to do? And the colonel said, you don't understand. These are not just 12 men. These guys are from Fort Bragg. They're special forces. They're Green Beret. These guys have a special skill set. But furthermore, they have access to the greatest weaponry known in the U.S. arsenal. This will defend. About 8 hours went by of planning and preparing and strategizing. And the call went out to all these Afghans, said, you need to retire yourself from the valley and pull back to our fighting position and get behind us. And just watch. That special forces commander gets on the phone and he calls for fire to the naval battleships. He calls for fire for the U.S. bombers and fighters. And in calling for fire, they sit back and watched, quote unquote, the glory of the weaponry that they were about to see. And that day, it wasn't about shooting the enemy. It was about taking out the mountain. For hours and hours and hours, the arsenal rained down, the whistling of different shells coming overhead and the fighters pulling in and never even seeing them, and all of a sudden they're pulling out one after one after one. When all the dust cleared, not only has the enemy been defeated, the mountain has been leveled. As I read that story, I got to thinking, are we truly aware of the weaponry that we have as special operators in the army of King Jesus? That, man, when everything is hopeless, I don't care how long that stronghold has been in your life. I don't care how long that curse has been wrecking your marriage. I don't care how far you think your child is gone. I don't care how much hurt. I do care, but I want you to understand, when I bow my knee and my head and my heart to the Lord Jesus, the Holy Spirit of God can unleash a weaponry, an arsenal of hope that can destroy not only the enemy in your life, but the mountain that enholds him, that encompasses him, and you can walk across on dry land. Mighty is the weapons to the pulling down of our strongholds. But you got to believe it. You got to know. Listen, what's the difference between that what a quote unquote normal soldier who's just pop, pop, pop firing an M16 versus the guy who gets on and says, all right, guys, let's show them what we got. It's a level, watch this, of authority and responsibility that is given to that guy. What is your level of responsibility as a child of the Most High God? You're the hope. You're called to be the light of the world, that Jesus' light hits you and reflects upon a dark place. The U.S. Navy's mantra is America's Navy, a global force for good. Paul went on to tell Timothy in the context of that mantra, watch what he says. He says, you need to preach the word. Everybody say, preach. There's an old saying from an old gentleman, Billy Sunday, used to say, preach the word and sometimes use words. They need to see your lifestyle, not just your words. Preach the word. Be instant. Everybody say instant. Be instant in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort. Watch this. With all long suffering and doctrine. Doctrine is biblical truth, not personal dogma. As Keith and the band gets ready to come back up, hear me. Not only a good soldier knows what side he or she is on, not only does he maintain a constant state of readiness, but watch this. A good soldier is motivated by the mission. Verse 4b says this, his aim is to please the one who enlisted him. Many writers and commentators today on the news would have you to believe that the military is trained to simply have blind obedience. Not so. They would have you to believe that these guys are just like robots saying, go attack that hill, and they go attack that hill. They get to know the what, the how, and the why. Every soldier is indoctrinated in those points of reference, whether it be in basic training, boot camp, in AIT, or special training, but they know it most importantly on the battlefield. And it comes from the top down to the lowest of low. And every single general, every chief of staff that's ever stood in the White House will tell you this. It goes all the way down to the lowest private. It matters at the lowest level that they know what we're doing and why we're doing it. What is our objective? They have to know the objective. Define leadership in military. The process of influencing a group of subordinates to accomplish a specific mission. Specific. That's our definition. I wonder sometimes, do we really know our marching orders? When you get to basic training, at least in the Army, the first few days is quite frightening. It's kind of shocking. It's very overwhelming. To some degree, I think you could explain it as they're breaking you down to nothing. I remember as a 17-year-old young man, I had not even turned 18 yet. And I remember arriving at Fort Benning, Georgia, and I remember the fear and the angst and everything that I went through for the first few days was just overwhelming. Then I remember them teaching us how to march. And we marched and we marched and we marched. Drilling ceremonies, we did it over and over and over and over and over and over again. I'm like, what has this got to do with war? They taught us general orders and what we're to do and what we're not to do. They teach you how to wear the uniform and not just wear it, but it has to be clean, has to be perfect. You went through the mud one day, the next day it better be clean and look like somebody took it to the cleaners. They teach you how to make a bunk, and the bunk has to be perfect. But it can't just be perfect. It has to be perfectly like everyone else, uniformity. And over and over, if you leave your locker undone, Lord forbid, they will take everything you have and throw it out the window, and you get to go get it 4, 5, 6 times, and your neighbors get to help you. And I'm like, and then all of a sudden, this went on for weeks and weeks and weeks, and learning how to do the weapon, learning how this, learning how that. And then I remember the day the drill sergeant, he took that round brown hat off, and he laid it down, and he looked at me. He looked like a man then. I had not seen that side of him. And he said, guys, tomorrow you will graduate from the United States Army. And you will be a soldier. And he started asking us questions. And, man, we were popping off the answers. From what we had done, we knew the answers. We had been doing it over and over and over again. A good soldier is motivated by the mission. What is our mission? Our mission is to, watch this, to be able to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ, the hope to a lost and dying world. You may come in here and hear it every single week, and you go, what's the point in all that? Let me tell you when it'll be the point. When you're out there and somebody comes to you and asks you the question about Jesus. The word of God, if it's hidden in my heart, as it goes forth, it will not return unto him void. In that moment, in that time, when you don't think you have the words to say, God will recall it, and you will just begin to speak it out with promise and with hope and with power. Keep doing it. 2 Corinthians 5, 9-11 tells us why. So whether we are at home, whether we are away, we make it our aim to please him. For one day we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each one, receive that what is due for what he or she has done in the body, whether good or bad. If you want to really go hear a good sermon, pull up the sermon, Payday Someday. Or read Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God. Read some of those, hear some of those old sermons. Let me tell you something. One day, you will kneel before your Creator and your Redeemer. And you know what? I believe there's not going to be a lot of questions. The only thing that's going to matter is one thing. What did you do with Jesus? What did you do with Jesus? I know my calling. How about you? I know why I'm here. Do you know why you're here? SEAL Team 6, when they removed Osama bin Laden, as soon as that mission was over, and you can imagine the gravity of that moment for taking out the world's most wanted man. And right after that was over, you would imagine the dialogue between these members of SEAL Team 6 to be somewhat like, man, we did it, high five. But one of the SEAL Team 6 members recalls the flight home. It was not fist bump. It was not braggadocious. It was not stories and narratives of what all had just occurred. In fact, there was not a word to be spoken. The commander of SEAL Team 6 takes out his cell phone or whatever device that they communicate with, and he typed in two letters, Charlie Mike, C-M. And they knew what that meant. It meant continue mission. You know what it means? Keep soldiering on. This is but one moment. This moment does not define us. Regardless of what the world thinks, what we need to realize is this, that we're not defined by a moment or a mission. We're continue to fight until I hang the uniform up. And when I hang it up, then I support those that are still wearing it. What about in the spiritual sense? What about the men and women who have gone before us, the preachers and the men and women of God who've poured in us? The U.S. Air Force mantra, aim high, fly, fight, and win. And then lastly, and I'm done, you need to be willing to pay the price for victory. Verse 3 says, share in the suffering as a good soldier. Every good soldier knows the price he or she pays for soldiering. You know that when you take the oath. It's a hardship. All gave some gave all. They find, though, in themselves an intestinal fortitude, a new level of can't quit and can do. I believe that children of God need to experience more. The enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy, but Jesus says, but I came that you may have life and have it how? More abundantly, exceedingly abundant above all we can ask, think, or imagine. Can I tell you what my drill sergeant told me? When you get to where you can do no more, you are now crossing the threshold of greatness. Dig down deep and soldier on. Can I tell you, Christian? Soldier on. Dig down deep. Maybe we should say this to the church today. Receive it in the heart that it was intended. Stop whining and start winning for Jesus. It matters because the world is watching. United States Marine Corps, probably the best known mantra. By the way, happy birthday to the Marine Corps yesterday, 243 years. Semper Fi. Semper Fidelis simply is the Latin phrase that means always faithful. Look to your neighbor right now and say, you need to be always faithful. Go ahead and tell them. Can you say that today? Can you say that you're always faithful? I want to enlist you today. If you happen to study Calvinism, you can look at it like you've been drafted. If you study Arminianism, you realize free will of man, then you just enlisted. I don't care how you got here. You in the soldier of the Lord. Here's what I believe today. I love this. I'm going to read this to you, and then we're done. I want you to listen to these words of an unknown writer, no doubt a soldier. Listen to what he says. I am a soldier of the army of God. The Lord Jesus Christ is my commanding officer. The Holy Scripture is my code of conduct. Faith, prayer, and the Word of God are the weapons of my warfare. I have been taught by the Holy Spirit, trained by experience, tried by adversity, and tested by fire. I am a volunteer in this army, and I am enlisted for eternity. I won't get out. I won't sell out. Won't be talked out. Won't be pushed out. I am faithful, reliable, capable, and I am dependable. If God needs me, I am there, for I am a soldier of God. I am not a baby. I don't need to be pampered, petted, primed up, pupped up, picked up, or pepped up. I am a soldier of God. No one has to call me, remind me, write me, visit me, entice me, or lure me. I am a soldier of God. I am not a wimp. I am in my place. I am saluting my king. I am obeying his orders. I am praising his name. I am building his kingdom. No one has to send me flowers, gifts, food, cards, or candy, or give me handouts. I don't need to be cuddled or coddled, cradled, cared for, or catered to. Why? Because I am committed. I cannot have my feelings hurt bad enough to turn me around from my God. I cannot be discouraged enough to turn aside. I cannot lose enough to cause me to quit. When Jesus called me by name in his army, I had nothing. If I end up with nothing, I will still come out ahead. I will win because I'm on the army of God. My God has and will continue to supply all my needs according to his riches and glory. I am more than a conqueror. I will always triumph. I can do all things through Christ. The devil can't defeat me. People can't disillusion me. Weather cannot weary me. Sickness cannot stop me. Battles cannot beat me. Money cannot buy me. Governments cannot silence me. And hell cannot handle me. And death cannot destroy me. For I am an army of this Lord. For when my commander calls me from his battlefield, he will promote me to captain and then allow me to rule with him. I am a soldier of the army of the Lord. And I'm marching on, claiming victory. I will not give up. I will not turn around. I am a soldier marching heaven bound. Here I stand. Will you stand with me? Y'all stand and give him praise today. He's worthy. Come on, church. You are enlisted in the army of the Most High God. Every head bowed and every eye closed today. Do you know that you know that you know that today you have hope and heaven for a home? If you came in here or you're watching today by way of Facebook, do you know today where you will spend eternity? If God should call you home, if you're not sure of that today, I want you to know that your first marching order is to get it right with God today. I don't care what you brought into this room today. God died for it. Today, you can go from being an enemy of God to being a trophy of his grace. It's your call. For by grace have you been saved through faith. It is not of your works or anything you can do, lest you would boast. It is the gift of God. How many of you can say, without any shying down, I'm a child of the Most High God? Lift your hands up really high. I'm a child of God. I know that I have heaven for a home. You can put your hands down. Praise God for all the hands. But a few didn't go up. What about you today? What about you today? Jesus came and he rescued you. From death, hell, and the grave. He rescued you from yourself and from a sin-stricken world. Would you pray with me from your heart to God right now? Pray with me. Father in heaven, I'm a sinner. Say this to him if you'd like to be saved. I know that I have broken your heart. Forgive me for all of my sin. Today, Jesus, save me. Help me to live for you until the day you call me home. In Jesus' name I pray. If you pray that prayer today with every head bowed and every eye closed, how many of you could just raise your hand and say, Mark, today I prayed and I invited Jesus into my heart. God bless you. I see hands over there, hands over there. Hands are going up all over the room. Hear me. Hear me. I want to ask Ben if you would come down. Michael, if you would over there. A couple of you to come down. Just stand right over here. Doug, if you would, come stand out here. Here's what I want you to do. We're going to bring the house lights down a little bit. We're going to sing one verse of a song. Here's what I want you to do. If you gave your life to Jesus today, I want you to step up today, and I want you to come down here and let us pray for you. If you've been battling something for far too long, today you heard the story of that Afghani war that was going on where they leveled that mountain, that stronghold, mighty. The weapons of your warfare today are not carnal, but they're mighty through the pulling down of strongholds. It can end today, my friend. It's up to you. The doors of our